Thanks everybody for coming. Today for Z-Evolution, we have a postdoc in my group, Stephanie Klein, and she's going to be presenting on lots of root analysis, connecting genome to phenome in maize roots. So take it away, Steph.
Thanks, Sarah. So today is a presentation about my project that I'm working on in Sarah's lab. That's also funded as part of this through a USDA NEPA postdoctoral fellow grant. A lot of what I've been doing is still very much a work in progress, but still very excited to share kind of what I've been up to over the last year and a half or so. I'm really interested in root responses to environmental stress, particularly how those responses are controlled. We are starting to look at or integrating genomics, transcriptomics with some of my physiology backgrounds to, as Sarah said, start to connect genome to phenome. To start, I thought I would just kind of talk about root architecture. Coming from Jonathan Lynch's lab at Penn State, he had this idea that we can improve crops through their root systems. And that's because roots are so important for the acquisition of various nutrients and water. And some of those root traits can be advantageous for acquiring different nutrients. And so in this cartoon, I have two kind of extreme examples of contrasting root system architectures. On the left, is one that is a combination of traits that Jonathan proposed as the steep, cheap, and deep idiotype. And so with this idiotype, its roots or nodal roots are growing at a steeper angle, and they're occupied by fewer longer lateral roots. There are several other traits involved in this overall idiotype, the idea is that this idiotype is more advantageous for acquiring mobile nutrients such as nitrogen and water that are more available at depth in the soil profile compared to this example on the right, which is more shallowly angled, has shorter, denser lateral roots, other things that factor into maybe being better able to acquire immobile nutrients that are more available at the shallow soil layers. And so since root angle is such a dominant component of these idiotypes, I became really interested in understanding how root growth angle is controlled under environmental stress. And particularly for my work, I've been focusing on this in the context of nitrogen stress. So part of that work from Jonathan's lab also found that root growth angle is plastic. These are kind of representative examples of the same genotype that was grown in two non-stressed environments, and then under a nitrogen stress and a drought stress environment. And you could probably tell that under these stressed environments, the root growth angle became steeper. And so this is a response that we've seen in a lot of different maize lines, but of course that degree of responsiveness varies by genotype. As I'll explain in a little bit. And so, moving to Sarah's lab, while I kind of focused more on the phenome prior to joining the lab, I was really interested in kind of building or bridging the gap between genotype and phenotype. And so, generally, this is like a very general schematic where there's maybe a gene that is transcribed at some rate within the transcriptome, which then affects phenotype. However, this kind of relationship is a little naive to assume that this is what the relationship is, especially after that really interesting conversation we had a few weeks ago through Merritt and Jim's presentation, where it's probably not very wise to assume that all of these things are controlled by just one gene. And so what I'm trying to do in Sarah's lab is to try to look around genes that may be associated with nitrogen stress responses and look at the genotypic variation that exists around interesting genes. And a lot of that genotypic variation is determined by variation in transposable element content, especially for maize. Transposable elements are really interesting because of how much they contribute to genotypic variation in maize, but they're also interesting for other reasons too. So TEs can really impact the transcriptional landscape. So if a TE moves into a gene, then it can affect transcription of this gene by introducing alternative splice sites, or it can affect transcription of the gene overall. So this has changed significantly. If a TE moves to nearby a gene, not necessarily in it, TEs are targeted for DNA methylation, and that methylation can spread into the surrounding regions around that TE, which can also impact transcription of a nearby gene. But then one part that is most interesting to me is that if a TE inserts near a gene and that TE maybe contains transcription factor binding sites or enhancer elements, well, then these TEs can be responsive to nitrogen or to any sort of environmental stress, cause those TFs to bind to those TF binding sites, and then render nearby genes to be environmentally responsive or stress responsive. And so this is kind of the avenue that I'm exploring more in how TEs can contribute to gene regulation in response to nitrogen stress with respect to root phenotypes. And so there has been some research showing that TEs are responsive to environmental stress. One of the most well-known examples is this family called Onsen, which has been studied pretty well in Arabidopsis. And it was found that mobilization of Onsen results in reduced rosette growth and increased heat stress sensitivity in Arabidopsis. So in this study by Roki et al. 2021, they compared the rosette growth and heat stress responses in various Arabidopsis lines, some of which had a high copy number of Onsen throughout the genome. And so they found, and these are graphs of three different high copy lines. And generally speaking, they observed this trend that the high copy lines were smaller and more sensitive to heat stress. So a lot of research done in this relationship between TE responsiveness to environmental stress has been conducted in cold stress, heat stress, drought stress. But there really hasn't been much research done in response to a mineral-based stress. And so one of the first things I did when I joined the lab was to just try to do some exploratory work using already published RNA libraries to see if we can sense any sort of responsiveness by TEs due to some change, like some variable nitrogen environment. And so in this study from Wang et al., they grew maize in hydroponics in a nitrogen-starved environment, moved them to a nitrogen-rich environment, and then tracked all these transcriptome-level changes. So using those RNA libraries, we looked at TE responses, and we actually found that a number of TE families and individual elements were differentially expressed under exposure to nitrogen. And so this was pretty interesting to us. And I examined a number of other studies as well, just to see kind of whether this responsiveness was repeated. And we did find a good amount of evidence to show that, TEs can be responsive to nitrogen or to variable nitrogen availability as well. And so looking at these TE families and TE elements a little bit closer, we found that, there are different orders of TEUs, and they're variably responsive to environmental changes. But most of the TEUs that we found in this study that were nitrogen responsive were long terminal repeat retrotransposons, which make up the bulk of TEUs, TE content that is in maize. This was very promising to us because LTRs seem to be the most environmentally responsive TEs based on studies in other organisms. Using kind of this information that, like all this background information, we generated this hypothesis that TEs are nitrogen responsive and they alter the activity of nearby genes to induce root growth angle responses to nitrogen stress. And so this is just kind of our working hypothesis, you know, some level of genotypic variation due to TEs is related to phenotypic variation that we observe in the root system. But before we could really kind of move into more targeted approaches to tease apart these relationships, we really had to figure out just how much genotypic variation there is in TE content, and also how much phenotypic variation exists in root growth angle. And so we were focusing on doing this kind of work in the NAM founders, just because it's a really wonderful resource to try to do these studies connecting genome to phenome. So over the last two field seasons, I've been working on phenotyping the root system and also quantifying variation at the genomic level. So starting with our genotypic variation, we know that TE content varies by genotype. Sarah, as part of her postdoc with Nathan Springer, did this study comparing TE content among four maize genotypes, B73, MO17, W22, and PH207. And this graph just shows that a pretty small fraction of all possible TE content is shared amongst all four genotypes. And a lot of that content is fairly unique to an individual genotype. And so these differences become even more apparent once you start to look at the level of the NAM founders, or the 26 different genomes. And so this graph just kind of shows too that, or this graph on the right, I actually don't really know if you can see my cursor. I hope you can. This graph on the right shows that the amount of TE content varies, or TE content varies by genotype. This study on the right didn't really do pairwise comparisons yet. So we don't know we don't know the presence-absence variation yet. So that is something I've been working on, but we do know that just by numbers, the TE content varies by genotype. And so one of the first things I started working on was adapting this pipeline from Sarah's previous study and doing all these different pairwise comparisons between B73 and each NAM founder to quantify the TE presence absence variation amongst the NAM founders. And so basically how this works is all of this is relative to B73. So using the B73 TE annotations, we isolated these flanking sequences of each TE and then aligned them to each NAM founder. And so if each of these flanking sequences, which I think were like the 250 base pairs surrounding the start and end points of each TE, aligned those to each NAM founder. If those sites were shared, then it was defined as shared site defined. If those flanking sequences were not found in the NAM founder, then they were defined as non-shared site defined. And then, there were a number of TEs which didn't necessarily fit either of these criteria, and so they are defined as unresolved. And so of the 323,000 TEs. About half of TEs are shared between B73 and each NAM founder. So remember, each of these are pairwise comparisons with B73. About 16,000 TEs are shared or are non-shared between B73 and each NAM founder, which means that those non-shared sites are likely new transposition events that occurred within B73. But then this green region is all the shared content. And we do have quite a large proportion of unresolved TEs, but those could be unresolved just because of how we were doing the alignment. So if I were to go back to this diagram. So these comparisons were performed in syntenic windows, and if there just was not a syntenic region identified in the NAM founder, then we, like, that led to a lot of those TEs remaining unresolved. But there's still a lot of information here that we can work with, and so we decided to move forward. Just looking a little bit more closely at how many genomes share the shared TEs. And there is a variable number of TEs that are shared amongst a variable number of genomes. And so on the graph here, this bar label 25, this is the number of TEs that are shared in all genomes. And that represents about 12% of the TEs that we evaluated. On the other side, this column labeled zero, that means all the TEs that are unique to B73. And then in column one, all of the TEs that are unique to B73 and only one other NAM founder. And then this continues on over the graph. And so this is really promising to see. This is a graph like this, or a graph that has a shape like this is pretty, or has been found in other studies like this. And so we felt pretty happy that we were on the right path. So now that we've established that there is some level of genotypic variation in TE content, let's take a look at the phenotypic variation and root growth angle. So as I said, over the last 2 years, we've been phenotyping the NAM founders for their root system architecture, focusing on root growth angle. So we grew these in the field at Curtis Farm, which is just south of campus. And around V10 stage, we excavated the plants from the field using just standard shovels. So if you're unfamiliar with the process of shovelomics, which comes from Jonathan's lab, we dig up the plants and harvest the mass of the root crown. That is about one shovel head in radius around the base of the plant and one shovel head deep. And we actually harvested these plants a little earlier than we normally would, just because we are primarily interested in crown roots. And so as long as the plants had pretty clear brace roots, we felt comfortable harvesting those from the field. Once we excavated those, we brought them to our washing station. Here we just used a power washer that was set on its lowest setting, and that helped to clean the roots really nicely. Brought them back to our greenhouse where they could dry. And then we built this phenotyping booth that allowed us to take images of the root crown. And then in those images, we would use ImageJ to measure the root growth angle. So looking at just the NAM founders, here are some representative examples of root crowns of each NAM founder plus a handful of other genotypes that we were interested in looking at. So looking at this slide, you might notice some variation. I should mention in each of these individual panels, the left root crown is representative of the high nitrogen treatment. And then on the right figure is a crown that was grown under our low nitrogen treatment. So there is some variation here. So for example, P39, its roots appear to be growing at a pretty steep angle relative to say Texas 303 right next to it, which especially under high nitrogen, its roots seem to be growing at a more shallow angle. But you know, looking at these root crowns, we can see variation here, but we're actually missing out on a lot of phenotypic variation that exists like deeper in the root crown. So what we ended up doing was phenotyping the root growth angle at each whorl. And so in the root system, the roots are organized by whorls. And so the first roots to emerge, or the first nodal roots to emerge, occur at whorl one. And then they more roots will emerge at each whorl as the plant develops. And then any nodal roots that emerge above ground are classified as brace roots. For the purposes of this study, we weren't super interested in those brace roots. So we cut all those off and then focused on what was happening in the crown roots here. So just looking at this kind of progression of images, you might notice like some slight change in root growth angle. So in whorl six, these roots seem to be growing at a much steeper angle relative to those at whorl one. Made it clear that it's important to quantify this variation at each whorl to kind of better understand, you know, what the overall root system architecture may be. And then also we can look at what the angle of these roots are relative to the vegetative developmental stage or like key moments of like key developmental stages later. So as I mentioned before, we took these images and measured them in ImageJ. And on the next slide, I'm going to show you a graph that is kind of analogous to that array of root crowns that I showed you of all the different genotypes a couple slides ago. But I kind of want to take a second to explain kind of what those graphs are. So we took each of these images and then measured the root growth angle at each of these whorls. But then, you know, just to kind of visualize the phenotypic variation that we see in each genotype, I wanted to kind of make a cartoon schematic recreation of what the root system architecture would look like if you just chopped the root crown right in half and you could see the angle of each whorl. So here, the individual root angle measurements stacked on top of each other. So whorl one is purple, that is placed at the bottom because that is where whorl one would exist on a real root crown. And then stacked one on top of another until we reach whorl six, as the top one here. And so this is B73. We made this cartoon, and then this is what the actual graph would look like. So down here, again, would be the angle measured for whorl one, and then up here, whorl six. This graph is split in half to show even further the effects of low nitrogen stress on root growth angle. And so on the left-hand side of this graph is what the root growth angle would look like under high nitrogen, but on the right is what it would look like under low nitrogen. And then there will be some lines that are colored, and that color corresponds to, a Kruskal-Wallace significance test, just to test if that change in root growth angle due to stress is significant or Wilcoxon test, sorry. And so looking at this whole graph, these are all the individuals that we grew in 2021, B73 up here, and then all of the NAM founders, except for a couple that were just very uncooperative in our field. There are a couple of tropical lines that just really did not like growing in Iowa. So I think like CML247 is not included, or 277, which was a little disappointing, but not unexpected. And then there are a couple other, or these are just the NAM founders that I have included in this graph. And so looking at this, hopefully some of this greater root growth angle phenotypes and the variation that exists within the NAM founders is even more apparent than that earlier slide where the brace roots may have been blocking some of this variation that we see. And so just to kind of point out some differences, sticking with B73, since this is a genotype that we're all so familiar with, it's fairly steeply angled. And I think in those images that I showed you earlier, it looks even more steep from those actual images. But overall, B73 appears to be pretty steep, in contrast maybe with KI11, which is pretty shallow. KI3 is also shallow, but it becomes more steep at different whorls as a result of stress. But one of the genotypes that became really interesting to us is Ohio7B because it seems to be the most responsive to stress. And so starting out, it wasn't particularly shallow. Ohio7B is actually more of a its root growth angle is average, but that becomes much steeper as a result of nitrogen stress. We really wanted to focus on these contrasting responses to nitrogen stress between B73 and Ohio7B. And just to actually kind of put a real picture to what this looks like, here's B73 under high nitrogen, low nitrogen. Its root growth angle really doesn't look all that different. This crown is maybe just a little smaller, but under Ohio7B, this change in root growth angle is pretty apparent. And so these two genotypes kind of became the basis for the experiments that I've been working on this year. And then, you know, knowing that this phenotypic contrast exists, we went back and took a look again at the genotypic variation of these two lines. Just like all of the other NAM founders, about half of TEs present in B73 are present in Ohio7B. You know, that means that there's a lot of content that isn't necessarily shared. And so there's a lot of interesting comparisons and studies that we can do with this information. And so, you know, starting from this original hypothesis, we devised two series of experiments. The first one being an RNA-seq study for root nitrogen responsiveness in these two lines. And then the other one became a more of a field-based analysis where we wanted to use the family of RILs or recombinant inbred lines that was used as part of the larger NAM panel to maybe start to identify specific regions, either genes or genomic regions that could be connected to nitrogen responsiveness. And then ultimately, this RNA-seq study may help us develop our experiments with the RILs. But starting with our RNA-seq, this is something I've been working on a lot lately. So we grew B73 and Ohio7B in the greenhouse. It was really important, in my mind, to develop a system where we could grow this in an actual like solid media rather than hydroponics, which has been what most root transcriptome studies have been done with. You know, it hydroponics is really convenient for harvesting roots and quickly collecting your tissues and freezing them, but it may not be the best environment to try to make comparisons to observations we see in the field. And so we grew these seedlings in a sand culture in these containers that were a little under a liter in volume and for 3 weeks under high and low nitrogen. And so B73 didn't really exhibit much change under the low nitrogen treatment. There's about a 10% increase in shoot biomass under low nitrogen, but Ohio 7B was much more responsive and had a 22% reduction in shoot biomass under low nitrogen. It does look like Ohio 7B was bigger than B73 under high nitrogen, but based on these relative comparisons, Ohio 7B was much more responsive. So after growing these for 3 weeks in the greenhouse, we took the containers. You kind of push out the contents of these containers, and we push them into this basket where we could shake off most of the sand without damaging the root system too much, which was really nice. And then once we removed most of the sand, just dipped them into some water really quickly, and the sand fell away from the root system really easily. And then from each of the second and third whorl roots, we collected tissues from three different zones along the root axis. And so we collected root tips, which we call zone one. And then the younger root tissue that hasn't yet developed lateral roots as a second tissue type, which we call zone two. And then further up the root axis, we collected tissue that is more mature and has developed lateral roots, and we call that zone three. So all in all, this whole harvest process took about like 1 minute from the time that we pull it out of the container to throwing the individual tissue types into the liquid nitrogen. So it was nice that this whole system worked pretty quickly for us. And so with this RNA-seq experiment, this is very, very much a work in progress. And I really cannot emphasize enough how preliminary these results are, because I just got the sequencing data a couple weeks ago. And so, but I wanted to share kind of this exciting initial analysis that I did. And so right now I've been focusing more on the genes aspect of this. We're still working on quantifying expression of TEs under this variable nitrogen availability. But with respect to genes, in zone one, we found a number of differentially expressed genes in each genotype as a result of nitrogen stress. So in B73, there were over 1,000 genes that were upregulated and 877 genes that were downregulated as a result of nitrogen stress in the root tip. But what was really interesting to me is Ohio 7B had almost twice as many differentially expressed genes, over 2,200 of them being upregulated, over 1,400 of them being downregulated in the root tip. And so this is really interesting to me because just the way that just from what we know of how root growth angle is determined, you know, it is a gravitational response. A lot of how root growth angle is determined is probably due to what's happening in the root tips, that sensing in the root tips. And so to see that Ohio 7B, which is more responsive to nitrogen stress, has nearly twice as many differentially expressed genes is relative to what's happening in B73. Is pretty interesting. But like I said, we are at very early stages of this. So I'm hoping that in even just a few months' time, I can share some more exciting data. So now moving into our experiment with the RILs in the field, again, this is very much a work in progress, but we grew these rills in the field under high and low nitrogen stress, have been working on phenotyping those. But while we've been doing that, I've also been working to quantify to quantify the genotypic variation within the rills, and really looking to figure out whether various genomic features like genes or TEs are derived from B73 or Ohio7B. And so using the genotypic information that we have using a SNP panel, we determine the parental origin of each gene and TE. So for an individual gene or TE or feature, I'll probably call them from now on, we looked at the SNPs surrounding the feature, the nearest SNPs, and if both of these SNPs were the same as what was in B73, then this feature was defined as B73 derived. Conversely, if these neighboring SNPs matched the SNPs that were found in Ohio7B, then this feature was Ohio7B derived. And if these SNPs did not match, then this feature was defined as ambiguous. So we did an initial pass at this, and then we were able to impute some missing data just based off of, we were able to fill some gaps just using information for genes that had been classified correctly, or genes and TEs that had been classified correctly. And so luckily we were actually able to classify the parent-derived alleles for about 82% of features. This graph here just is a random collection of TEs, which are these longer names, and genes that I just kind of wanted to look at the amount of information that we had for various features across the genome. And so this is just a count on the number of, for the bars that are here. So the blue represents the number of individuals that have an Ohio7B derived allele. The green is the number of individuals that have a B73 derived allele. And then the red are those that have no information. And so even in this collection of random features, there are only a few of them that have no information at all. Like this TE here, these two here. And so most of them actually have a decent number of rills that we have information for. So this is really promising to me that we can do these interesting comparisons and have, I don't know, maybe 60, 70, 80 individuals represented of each allele. We can do some really interesting comparisons. I did want to kind of look at the genome overall and see if there are any regions that we were missing information. And unfortunately, it looks like there's just this big block on chromosome 2 where I think, you know, they're just wasn't very good sequencing data or in the SNP panel. And so it was really difficult to determine whether these features were B73 or Ohio7B derived. And that's just unfortunate, but that's okay. We still have a lot of, a lot to look at. There's maybe this other region on chromosome 8, which has no representation. And then there are like some clear regions that have lower representation, like these yellow blocks on chromosome 6 and 7 and 10. But you know, that's still 100 individuals that we can make comparisons with. As I mentioned already, the phenotypic variation there is wide root phenotypic variation in root growth angle within this real family, but we're still processing those root crowns from the field. And so this isn't all of the root crowns. We're actually probably halfway through that work. But from what we have already, it looks like there is pretty wide variation in root growth angle. And we're measuring this at the fourth whorl. And we determined this just based off of some analyses we did using the NAM founders. We wanted to see if there were particular whorls that maybe helped or that helped define shallow versus steep versus average more effectively than other whorls. And it seemed like the fourth whorl was a good whorl to measure as like a representative whorl for the whole root system architecture. And so on this this density plot, we can see that the under both high and low nitrogen, the root growth angle varies from 0 to 78 or something. And we're not seeing like a major shift overall in low nitrogen, but what we are seeing is that there is a pretty wide range of plasticity responses and results as a result of this nitrogen stress. And so this dotted line at 0 means that there was no plastic response. But on either side of that, you know, this ranges from negative 40, meaning that the root growth angle became 40 degrees shallower, to about 35, meaning that the root growth angle became 35 degrees steeper. And so having this degree of variation is really nice to have so that we can start to make those comparisons or to try to find those relationships with the variation that we're seeing at the genotypic level. So our overall goal is to tie both of these data sets together by building a model where we can potentially predict the response to nitrogen stress in root growth angle to the activity of various genomic features. And so just to kind of summarize where I'm at and what I presented to you today, we have demonstrated that there is considerable variation in TE content and root growth angle within the NAM and RILS. But there's still a lot of work to be done. One of the things that I aim to do is, especially with this RNA-seq data, is to kind of move to the network level. So how do TEs modulate transcriptional networks overall to influence or affect these root phenotypes and these responses to stress? And then one of the other things that we can do, like working, especially working with this real set, is build models. We can also do a QTL analysis to identify various regions that may be contributing most strongly to our root growth angle responses. And so the goal is to identify genes or in particular genes and TE pairs that may affect these phenotypes or identify various structural variants related to root phenotypes and nitrogen stress responses. And so with that, I want to thank my lab, especially thank the farm staff who help us with planting and a bunch of other stuff. And then again, acknowledge USDA NEPA for funding my research. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
Great job, Steph. It looks like Matt is asking some questions in chat. Matt, do you want to unmute and ask your questions?
Sure. You guys hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Stephanie. I've been typing them in all along the way, so.
No worries.
Yeah, the first one I had was, I'm just curious, so you were looking at TE expression and considering that as a response to stress, and I'm curious about your thoughts about how that might also be related to increased transposition. So there's that hypothesis of environmental shock, often, you know, resulting in demethylation and lack of constraint of TEs, and that generates potentially, you know, adaptive variation with these novel TE insertions. I know that's not a focus of your study, but I'm just curious, you know, your thoughts on that and how you might study that, you know, if we wanted to explore that hypothesis too.
Yeah. You know, that's a really good question. It would be really interesting to follow that kind of avenue of experimentation, and kind of follow a similar strategy that the Roki et al. Paper did by comparing high copy number lines to lower copy number lines with respect to individual TE families. I think, though, that there's still so much more that we need to do to just identify which TEs or TE families may be involved in those environmental stress responses in maize, that we can't really get to that step just yet.
Okay. Yeah, and my second question, so I think you measured above ground biomass when you grew the plants in the cones, like B73 and Ohio 7B. Did you also measure the below ground biomass as well? Or, you know, maybe better yet, look at the ratio between above and below to see if kind of the plant is, you know, redirecting resources to increased root biomass relative to above ground?
Yeah, so we didn't do that through the RNA-seq experiment, but I have an undergrad working with me who's been looking at that relationship. We had some kind of wonky results from that greenhouse experiment, so we are planning on repeating it, and I can hopefully get you a better answer to that question. You know, just as a result of the root harvest with the RNA-seq study, we're chopping up the root system, so we can't also measure below ground mass biomass with the shoot biomass, but yeah, I should be able to have a better idea, especially that root to shoot ratio, how that changes in our specific system in the greenhouse.
Yeah, I was just looking at the photos, you know, with and without the nitrogen treatment, and it looked like Ohio 7B had increased, you know, below ground biomass, but you know, that might not be real. It might just be, you know.
Right.
Yeah, and then I guess my last question I typed in. So so you're looking at these features, and I think I understood that to be kind of TE presence absence across the lines. Is that primarily what you mean by the features?
I didn't really convey this point very well, but I mean, we are looking at genes too, because the genes may be the ones that are ultimately contributing are more strongly associated with these phenotypic variations that we're seeing, but they could be regulated by TEs. And so, you know, if we're trying to use presence-absence variation, using the NAM founders for that is beneficial. I don't know if we could generate that for like the real family. Would be cool if we could, but I don't think we can. But I don't think that actually gets to your question.
Yeah, I was just kind of imagining it would be nice to place the TE level variation in context of other variation. So, I mean, if you could include also gene presence absence variation and maybe even SNP level variation and mm-hmm. do something like a variance component analysis just to show, you know, how much of that root angle variation is due to TEs alone. And is that kind of a disproportionate, you know, explanatory variable in terms of that phenotype? So that might be, you know, something additional you could do. I mean, I think you could impute, you know, you could impute the genetic architecture of your RILs, which it sounds like you already have, and then, you know, take the parental data in terms of presence, absence, variation, SNP level variation, and include that. I mean, there's a lot of linkage. It's going to be hard to get down to the causal polymorphism.
Right. Yeah.
But yeah, I wonder if placing those in context of other types of variation too, just, you know, that might be helpful just in terms of the relative importance.
Okay. But, yeah, no, that's a really great idea. I can talk to Sarah about that.
Cool. But really great experiments that you're doing here. Super cool stuff. I'm, you know, obviously really into it because I'm asking lots of questions.
So. Thank you.
Hey, this is Joe Gage. I'm impressed with the amount of root phenotypic data that you've collected. It looks like a lot of work. I'm curious, what are the heritabilities for the different root angle traits that you're measuring?
Yeah, so as of this morning, I literally thought to myself, oh, I probably should have calculated these heritabilities before giving this talk, because I knew I'd probably get a question about that. You know, I haven't calculated for my experiments specifically, but I'm just trying to think back to past studies where we would, you know, measure root growth angle within the Wisconsin diversity panel. And I want to say, I think it was like around 0.6. I'll have to go back and check that. But the thing with root phenotypes is they're so variable. You know, I think roots are really cool, but I acknowledge that root phenotype data is extraordinarily messy. And so that kind of ends up resulting in inheritabilities that look pretty low. But when I can tell you just from when I was like making that slide with all of the representative root crown images, I had like sorted all of my root crowns by genotype and treatment, and just like looking at all of them right next to each other, I was pretty shocked to see like how repeatable those phenotypes were. And so, yeah, I wish I could give you a better answer on heritability, but it's probably around.
Thanks. Yeah, I do think it's pretty striking, the differences between genotypes, and there's definitely like visually variation there. But I would definitely be curious how well your quantification is capturing that.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks though. It's very, like I said, impressive amount of phenotypic data, very cool study.
Yeah, thanks. And I also should say, you know, I really only presented the 2021 phenotypic data, but for the NAM founders, at least, we have finished phenotyping that set. So I can start doing more of these, you know, season comparisons. So yeah. I'll get back to you on that.
Thanks, Steph. That was really cool. I was curious when you mentioned you were going to quantify the levels of retrotransposon expression, if you had any idea of how high those would be. Like, did you need a lot of RNA-seq reads for that, or are they similar to other genes?
Expression of TEs tends to be lower than genes. But we didn't really like plan to increase the coverage. We just kind of followed a pretty standard RNA-seq protocol.
Thanks.
All right, any last questions for Steph? All right, thanks everybody for coming. This is actually the last Z-Evolution of the semester. The speakers next week are postponing. So thanks for coming, and I will get this posted, and have happy holidays and stay warm.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.